Hello friends, welcome to the EPG Pathshala. I'm Dr. Smita Desai. I'm a practicing educational psychologist. I head a center known as Drishti, which works with children with special education needs. And I also work with schools where we utilize a lot of principles of educational psychology. So today we're here to talk about educational psychology and for me to tell you some methods of data collection in the field. The meaning, nature, and scope of educational psychology. The meaning, educational psychology is a branch of psychology that is concerned with studying the behavior of the learner with respect to her or his educational needs and educational environment. It uses the knowledge and principles of psychology to seek an understanding of the processes of learning and teaching. It is a scientific study of human behavior in the educational setting. Some impactful definitions include that of C.E. Skinner, who stated that educational psychology is that branch of psychology which deals with both teaching and learning. It deals with the behavior of human beings in educational settings. E.A. Peel states that educational psychology is the science of education. It helps the teacher to understand the development of his pupils, the range and limits of their capacities, the processes by which they learn, and their social relationships. Edward Lee Thorndike is considered the father of educational psychology in the 20th century. He studied how animals learn through the process of trial and error. Thorndike applied these laws of associative learning to humans and to education. This led to the first book in the area of educational psychology, called Educational Psychology in 1903 by Thorndike. In this book, he discussed the law of effects, which stated that rewarded behaviors become more frequent. Over the years, work on this law made it one of his most important principles of educational psychology. His work put the study of learning and education in the realm of scientific inquiry for the first time. Nature. Educational psychology uses the scientific methods of objective data collection with the purpose of understanding, predicting, and controlling human behavior in educational settings. It draws upon other fields of psychology, such as developmental psychology, clinical psychology, social psychology, in order to study the behavior and educational experiences of students in their learning environment. It aims to provide an understanding of the nature and purpose of education, the scientific methods used in arriving at the principles of educational psychology, to propose different principles and techniques of learning, methods of measuring learning characteristics in school, different dimensions of the learner, physical, cognitive, emotional, social growth. Teaching techniques for optimal learning. Measures to facilitate student adjustment in the classroom. Educational psychology aims to use its scientific activity towards providing the best fit between a student and his or her educational environment. Scope. The learner. Educational psychology, as an applied branch of psychology, throws light on the developmental characteristics of the learner and individual differences in intelligence and personalities, their attitudes and interest. It also tries to explain the causes for these individual differences which affect the learner and learning process. Educational psychology helps inform about the most desirable learning experiences, the stages of development that they should optimally be present so as to maximize the benefit to the learner. Educational psychology provides knowledge about learning processes, factors that affect the process of learning, such as maturation, cognition, attention, perception, memory, motivation, interest, etc., that could affect learning. It also studies the environmental factors of home, community, and learning situations, which come between the learner and the teacher. The teacher is central to any scheme of teaching and learning. educational psychology emphasizes the optimal personality traits, interests, and characteristics required for effective teaching. It also outlines the roles of the teacher in the classroom and the process to actualizing this role. Child development. Educational psychology also studies growth of development across different domains, roles of heredity and environment, personality and its differences, and the application of all these in the educational setting. B. The twin approaches to research in psychology, nomothetic and ideographic. The 19th century German philosopher Wilhelm Winderband introduced these terms, nomothetic and ideographic, to explain the two approaches to research. A. The nomothetic, which is the quantitative approach. In this approach, one conducts careful and systematic observation and experimentation in order to derive results that are more generalizable. Commonly used methods are the experimental method and the testing method. B. The ideographic or the qualitative approach. This approach tends not to use inferential or descriptive statistics, but rather uses qualitative methods of data gathering, such as interviews, diaries, and other written materials obtained from or provided by the respondents of a particular research. This approach is designed to derive meaning particular to the research target and is not necessarily designed for extrapolating generalizations. C. The methods of data collection in educational psychology. The first, introspection. Distinct to the field of psychology, it involves looking within, that is, reflecting on the inner workings of one's mind. It is a method of observation, but is made by the self. It is not random and usually has a specific goal or purpose. Popular forms of this are questionnaires and anecdotal data. Questionnaires. A questionnaire is an instrument which is used for research, which consists of a series of questions designed for the purpose of gathering information from respondents. Construction of a useful questionnaire that minimizes interfering problems requires experience, skill, thoughtfulness, and time. A well-designed questionnaire should meet research objectives. The design of the questionnaire depends on whether the researcher wishes to collect qualitative or quantitative information. The following steps are followed for designing a questionnaire. Step 1. Decide the information that is required and the target respondents. 2. Choose the method of execution, that is, of reaching the target respondents. 3. Decide the question content and put the formulated questions in a logical order. 4. Put questions into a meaningful order and format. 5. Conduct a pilot of the questionnaire and make the required changes. 6. Develop the final questionnaire format. Advantages of questionnaires. Data can be collected on large numbers of participants quickly and relatively inexpensively. The sample can be very large and geographically representative. Often, anonymity can be easily maintained. When constructed properly, a questionnaire provides data that can be organized easily, tabulated, and analyzed. Disadvantages of questionnaires are they are considered inadequate to understand some forms of information, for example, changes of emotions and feelings. The respondent may not be truthful while answering the questionnaire. There is no way of telling how much thought a respondent has put in while answering the questionnaires. The respondent may misunderstand the questions. B. Interviews. In the field of social science research, the usefulness of interviews has long been recognized. Interviewing is a method of collecting qualitative data and is valuable not only because it builds a holistic snapshot, analyzes words, reports detailed views of informants, but also because it enables interviewees to speak in their own voice and express their own thoughts and feelings. According to Dorney, a good qualitative interview has two key features. It flows naturally and it is rich in detail. There are two types of interviews: structured and standardized interviews. Appropriate questions are selected. The order and sequence is decided beforehand. The type of answer or response is aligned with the objective of the study. The second type is unstructured and non-standardized. Here, the interviewer doesn't decide on the set of questions or order. It is regarded as less objective and reliable. However, the subject has enough opportunity for self-expression. Execution of interviews. Before taking an interview, the following points should be attended to. First, plan the goal of the study and locate the population or sample of individuals to be interviewed. Second, acquire enough training in interview techniques. Three, ensure that the physical and psychological conditions of the interview are appropriate. To execute an interview, while conducting the interview, the following points should be kept in mind. The interviewer must introduce self. The interviewee must get sufficient time to respond. The interviewer should listen and not do all the talking. Clarification and elaborations must be sought if necessary. Some advantages of interviews. One, it is economical. No lab equipment, no large subject pool. It is pure and unadulterated data. The individual reports all that goes on in his or her mind and gives a holistic idea of the phenomenon. Disadvantages of the interview are, it is unverifiable. As it is not objective, it cannot be verified by others. The act of introspecting can taint it, thus becoming retrospection. Two, observation. The observation method may be regarded as one of the most convenient and appropriate methods for the study of human behavior. The individual's behavior is observed by somebody other than that person himself. This method is also called the method of objective observation, as against introspection, which is a method of self-observation. The behavior observed may be expressed in the form of bodily changes, bodily action, gestures, facial expression and speech. Observations may be carried out in many ways, forms and styles. The most common classifications include formal observations, informal observations, participant observations, non-participant observations. Formal observations are observations carried out in a formal manner by observing necessary formalities like providing the information to the individual or individuals about the nature and purpose of the observation, the date and timing and place of observation, the names and introduction of the observers, any necessary pre-work needed on part of the subjects. Advantages of formal observations. By randomly selecting observation times, the results observed may be more accurate. The observer also takes the process seriously, since the format of the formal observations is more structured. Some disadvantages of observations are that such type of observations cannot prove very fruitful in terms of drawing some reliable and valid conclusions about behavior and personality of the subject, since the subject knows that he or she is being observed. Next, informal observations. This is unstructured and unobtrusive. Additionally, informal observation may also be a precursor to formal observation and carried out when the experimenter knows little about the group being observed. Advantages of informal observations. Since the subject is being observed in such natural situations, we may get a realistic and true picture of things, events, traits, and characteristics of the subject's behavior. Disadvantages of informal observations are that since the observations are unstructured, the observer may or may not be very professional while doing such observations and may collect data which is not very easy to collate and tabulate. Participant observations. In this type of observation, the observer tries to observe the behavior of an individual or individuals by joining them as an associate or participant in any of their individual or group activities. Advantages of participant observations are that it allows for insight into context, relationships, behavior. It can provide information previously unknown to researchers that is crucial for project design, data collection, and interpretation of other data. Disadvantages of participant observations include that it is time-consuming. Documentation relies on memory, personal discipline, and diligence of researcher. It requires conscious effort at objectivity because the method is inherently subjective. Non-participant observations involve observing participants without actively participating. This option is used to understand a phenomenon by understanding the community or social system involved while staying separate from the activities being observed. Advantages of non-participant observations. It allows the researcher to see the actual occurrences and therefore even observe body language and changes in feelings and behavior. Researcher can be less likely to feel sympathy and therefore produce biased data. More ethical if it is done without participating in the actual task. Disadvantages of non-participant observations. It can lead to the Hawthorne effect because people tend to act differently when they know they are being observed. May be hard to gain accurate results as watching from outside, time-consuming and costly. Techniques for observation. One is the frequency method. The observer simply counts the number of occurrences of the behavior of interest in a given interval of time. The frequency method of recording observational data is most appropriate with discrete responses that take a relatively constant period of time to complete. For example, number of cigarettes smoked, number of words spoken, or the number of hand flapping incidents. Duration method. This is important when we want to measure the duration of the response. For example, using the duration method of observation, we might measure the duration of time spent either in a social or academic activity. Using a stopwatch, the observer activates the instrument when the behavior begins and terminates the time recording when the behavior ends. Next is the interval method. The interval method of observation is the most flexible and widely used recording method. This method permits the recording of any behavior, whether discrete, that is hand flapping, or continuous, like sleeping. With this method, the observation period is broken into equal intervals, the size of which varies with the particular observations of interest. Behavior is recorded as occurring yes or not occurring no in each interval. Third is the experimental method. According to Chapin, an experiment is an observation under controlled conditions. In this method, all conditions or variables affecting the behavior are held constant or unchanged or controlled, and only one specific condition is changed. All the variables being measured are called the dependent variables, known as the DV. The variable being changed is called the independent variable or the IV. The change in the DV is attributed to to the change in the IV. Characteristics of the method. 1. Observation is under controlled conditions. Certain variables are held constant and all possible variables are taken into account. 2. Randomization. Whether the person is exposed to the independent variable, that is the feature of interest, or not, is decided on a purely random basis. 3. Replication. The results can be replicated under the same criteria to get the same results. The different steps of the experimental method. 1. Statement of the problem. 2. Formulation of hypothesis. 3. Designing the independent and dependent variables. 4. Controlling the conditions of experiment. 5. Selection of the experimental design. 6. Analysis of the result. 7. Verification and confirmation of the hypothesis by the result of the experiment. Advantages of the experimental method are that it is reliable, valid, and precise. Results can be replicated. It is not limited to a specific population. There is quantitative measurement. Some disadvantages of the experimental method are that it is lengthy and time-consuming. It can be expensive. There might be difficulty in controlling all of the independent variables. The fourth method is the case study or clinical method. The case study method often involves simply observing what happens to or reconstructing the case history of a single participant or group of individuals. A case history traces the family and health, history, hereditary factors, classifies the developmental data, the educational progress, interpersonal and interparental or intraparental relationships. Generally, this method is used to understand the causes and sources of people's feelings. There are two major types of case studies, intrinsic and instrumental case studies. The cases in intrinsic case studies are chosen because the researchers want to know about them in particular, more than about a more general problem or phenomenon. Instrumental case studies constitute examples of a more general phenomenon. The research question identifies a phenomenon, example, stress, fame, etc., and the cases are selected in order to explore how the phenomenon exists within a particular case. Subjects of a case study. Certain subjects are more common in the case study method, as it is commonly applicable to those in need of assistance or for whom modification is necessary. They may include creative people, gifted individuals, delinquents or criminals, people suffering from maladjustments, or people with addictions. Some of the advantages of the case study method are that it is useful to understand the causes of a certain difficulty. It also allows for data to be gathered without manipulating any variable. It can generate a new hypothesis that can be tested using the experimental method. Some disadvantages of this method are that it is not necessarily objective. Also, it does not determine the complete cause-effect relationships. The next method is the genetic or the developmental method. This emphasizes developmental aspects of behavior. It looks at the causes of behavior in its beginning. The assumption is that to understand adult behavior, childhood beginnings must be fully understood and appreciated. Some advantages of this method are that it uses a holistic approach to development. It can pick up on variables that might otherwise have been skipped. Some disadvantages of the genetic method are that it is expensive. It is time consuming. The next method, which is the testing method, comprises psychological tests, educational measurements, rating scales, checklists, and questionnaires. In rating scales, we rate or judge an individual on the possession or absence of certain traits. The individual is then given a place on the scale or a score which indicates the degree to which a person possesses a given trait. The psychological tests are carefully devised and standardized tests for measuring different things like aptitude, interest, achievement, intelligence, and personality. Intelligence tests are used to measure intelligence or your ability to understand your environment, interact with it, and learn from it. Some intelligence tests include the Wechsler's Adult Intelligence Scale, also known as the WAIS, the Wechsler Intelligence Scale for Children, known as the WISC, and the Stanford-Binet Intelligence Scale, popularly known as the SB. Personality test traits are used to measure personality style and traits. Personality tests are commonly used in research or to assist with clinical diagnosis. Examples of personality tests include the Minnesota Multiphasic Personality Inventory, that is the MMPI, the Thematic Apperception Test, known as the TAT, Rorschach, also known as the Inkblot Test, attitude tests such as the Likert Scale or the Thurston Scale are used to measure how an individual feels about a particular event, place, person, or object. Achievement tests are used to measure how well you understand a particular topic, that is mathematics, etc. Aptitude tests are used to measure your abilities in a specific area, that is clerical skills or your mechanical skills. Achievement tests include Wechsler's Individual Achievement Test, the Peabody Individual Achievement Test. Aptitude tests include the Bloomberg Aptitude Test, that is the BAT, Armed Service Vocational Aptitude Battery. Some advantages of the testing method are that it is less expensive once the test is created and standardized. It allows for quick and efficient comparison across ages. It is replicable. The disadvantages of the testing method are that the process of standardizing is very time-consuming and expensive. It does not allow for the introduction of new variables. So, to summarize the entire module, educational psychology caters to the needs of the learner, the process, and the teacher. Gathering data and analyzing it effectively is paramount in the field as it leads to reliable changes in policy at a macro level and a change in teaching practices at a micro level. The methods of data collection in this module start with the method of introspection and is popular usage by means of questionnaires and interviews. The multiple methods of observation, that is formal and informal, participant and non-participant, have all been enlisted above. The scientific experimental method, with its wide-ranging applicability and characteristics to attempt attainment of high levels of validity and reliability, have been enumerated. It is important to note that the shortcomings of the methods must be kept in mind and tackled using controls to effectively utilize the methods. The clinical or case study method as a tool to gather data has also been discussed, with a distinction being made between intrinsic and instrumental methods. Twin studies as a highlight of the genetic or the developmental method has been characteristic of a lot of research on the nature versus nurture components in learning and education and is introduced here. Finally, the testing method with the various types of tests has been discussed. The testing process is integral to applied work in educational psychology and its usage is common to gain insight and variances in inter and inter-individual performance. Understanding the different methods of gathering data is essential to making an informed decision that ultimately stays true to the aim of the research study being conducted. So thank you, and I do hope that this particular lecture would be useful to you in your future, whether as a student, as a researcher, or as a practitioner. All the very best.